He let Phil Chuck play, although he didn't believe it, that he hadn't accepted a bribe. He suspended Hapes for life. He let Phil Chuck play in the game, and Phil Chuck played fairly well, a load of 4 interceptions and they lost. Later on, he suspended them for life and let them come back. That single moment saved the game. You would not be watching the Patriots if it had gotten wrong. So what did he do? And many of the things that Bert Bell put in still are around 70 years. He called J. Edgar Hoover when he wasn't following presidents and doing his routine, as we know, and said, I need to get a list of ex-FBI agents. And I want to plant them in every city. I will pay them to follow the players and check on the gamblers. And thus began, which today is now loaded. They spend millions on this investigative group for the NFL that can't even find a guy beating the hell out of his girlfriend in an elevator. That's how much these bumps are worth. So he hires them in every city. He also, which every team cheats on today, insisted that every club, this is for the gambling thing, be careful, report by Thursday who's injured and who isn't. There was a phone at our house. There was a red phone and there was a black phone. The red phone rang on Sunday morning. And of course, it was one of those things that I was told, you touch it, you'll be electrocuted. So I picked it up one day, one Sunday, because it kept ringing. And I met over a period of time, Hockey, Wingy, and Frisco Legs. These were 3 of the biggest gamblers in America who would start calling my father on Monday and call every day up to 10 minutes before game time with the odds. And if any of them fluctuated, I'll give you an example. The Bears were playing, I think, the Cardinals. And the Bears hadn't turned in that 2 of their players were hurt. Not seriously. The odds changed 4 or 5 points. So my father called right into the locker room. And he called Alice and he said, I want to know what the hell is going on here, or I won't let the game start. And they had to tell him, the 2 of the players, coaches hide everything, just ask Belichick. So, right? So that's what he did to protect the game, to bring the draft in, to put a lot of things in that are still in the game today. Also, which every commissioner, and Goodell was going to eventually lose that power, he had his brother, who at that time was the governor of Pennsylvania, later on became Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania, write into the Constitution that the commissioner had sole power to suspend, to do whatever he wanted in the best interest of the game. It's almost like saying, Trump says, you know what, I can pardon myself. So that's the way it was run. Careful, everything that he did through the game. We also looked at the Players Association, he recognized them, and the owners threatened to fire him. He said, you've got to give the players equal billing. You've got to give them the opportunity to do it. So that's briefly his background. Now let me go to the opening of the book, the chapter that is still very difficult for me to talk about. October the 11th, 1959. The Eagles, he found it, are playing the Steelers in the old at Franklin Field, where he was the star quarterback. It is a hot day. I walk in, try to get my free tickets, which didn't work. And I see him, which will remain to me to this day, about players and their play and what you're seeing with the NFL and what they've done to these players who are in. To see the HBO thing in terrible shape. And they're trying not to pay, which is BS. So walking out the door, And there's this old senator, his name was Boone Lipsky. He was my babysitter. In fact, I just found, Joanne O'Neill, my fiance, found a check made out to the player. Each player got $5 extra a week who either babysit me or my brother. That's one of them. That was how I got the check, right? So, walking out, Senator Bull lifts and said, I'm really down on my luck. But he said, you know, I have no money. Can you do something for me? In those days, there were no credit. So I went in those to his pocket, and I think it was his pocketbook, which I have today. Took out $100. He said, this is it. See me tomorrow. That's the last time I saw my father. Last 2 minutes of the game. The Eagles are driving with a winning touchdown. Warren Brand Bartlett, Hall of Fame quarterback, is throwing to Tommy McDonald, Hall of Fame receiver. Bobby Lane, Hall of Fame, kicks 3 or 4 field goals in the game, comes right down to the wire. Sitting there, 2 minutes left in the game, as McDonald crosses the goal line, I look over and a friend of mine hands me binoculars. He said, I know who that guy is, but it looks like Bert Bell. So I jumped over, ran across the field, ran up in the stands. In fact, the picture is in the book of where he died at Franklin Field. Got up there, and again, here are the ironies of your life. They rush up to try and save him. They go to the Steelers bench. It's funny in some ways, the way people wrote it, in other ways, not so damn funny. They brought up the oxygen, put it on his face, and it didn't work. And somebody said, that's the goddamn Steelers, they can't get anything right. And he died there. We got him in the ambulance, they took him up, broke the ambulance. And another thing that a lot of people don't know and talked about in the book, Art Rooney, who was his partner, and there that day, was so shocked. He walked up, the hospital was only a few blocks from Franklin Field. He walked up and forgot that he was walking in the middle of the trolley tracks. He came within that of being killed by a trolley walking up to see his friend. So from there, it is what we all in our own ways face in life. Now what do you do? Bert Bell's dead. Long live Bert Bell, but there ain't going to be too many people around going to help you once the power is gone. So I had a decision to make. I was playing basketball at South College at that time. Actually played against Wilt Chamberlain and many of the, not LeBron, of course, I'm too good for him. So what happened was Carol Rosenblum, who founded, no, didn't find, Carol Rosenblum, again, all of this is weaved together. Carol Rosenblum was a really good back at the University of Pennsylvania. His father was one of the richest people in this part of the country. Rosenblum and Marty Brill were there, and Marty Brill decided to leave and go to Notre Dame. He was PO'd at the coach. And Rosenblum was relieved too, and my father said to Rosenblum, you're making a big mistake. You can still be a star here. Don't do that. You'll be lost in the shuffle. He talked about it. He was a coach at the time. Ironically, 20 years later, Baltimore wants to bring a franchise back. He said, unless I can find somebody, ain't no way. The Colts sued him. And the person who sued him was a very, very famous attorney by the name of William D. McMillan. If you remember the whole story about the pumpkin papers, and that whole spy thing, Whitaker Chambers, that was the chief attorney. Told my father, we'll sue you unless you get it. Paul Rosenblum convinced him to do it for a down payment of $3,000 and another $100 or whatever it was. It's now, of course, worth $1 billion. Rosenblum takes over. Calls me and he said, if you want to go to training camp in 1960, you can go down there, and if you like it, you can come back here and work full time. That's not going to happen today. Ironically, and all of this is tied in, by the way, this book is also a history of America, and a lot of other things. Rosenblum's partner was Joe Kennedy. And I'm sure they screwed a lot of people together to do as well as they could. And so my first meeting with Rosenblum, he had a place in Atlantic City not far from us, so I go there, and it's just after JFK has won the floor and nominated in 1960. I'm sitting there with Rosenblum, and again, the things that you can get out of somebody in a private conversation you could not get today. We're watching the floor, and then we're watching JFK getting ready to go out and speak at the stadium. And Rosenblum turns to me and very prophetically said, "You know, I love the president to be," he said, "but if we've written in history, the greatest Kennedy is Ted Kennedy." And at that time, he was a playboy, he was doing everything. He said, "I've spent a lot of time on the floor." He said he was really more effective than Bobby. He said, "You will see someday, this guy will be one of the greatest." August 12th, 1960, watching at the Carol Rosenblum. And these are the things that you'll be swept up in history in the book when you see it. So anyway, I end up going to that camp in 1960. 58 and 59, the Colts were the Patriots of pro football. Johnny and I, so I still think, along with Brady, the greatest quarterback, two greatest I've ever seen. Raymond Berry, Lenny Moore, Jim Parker, Gino Marchetti, Big Daddy Lipscomb, until that tragic death, could have been one of the greatest of all time. By the way, Big Daddy also played for the Harlem Globetrotters. He was one of the best softball players in America. So you go to that camp. And I had been at the 58 championship game, and the only reason that I went to the game, I've been to so many championship games, my father said, "You come down to New York for this game?" And I said, "Is Joe DiMaggio and Marilyn Monroe going to be there? This is a jerky teenager." He said, "Yeah." I said, "Okay, I'm going to the game." So I end up meeting DiMaggio and the whole routine. So I go to the Colts training camp. And to explain to it, for any of you here who have gone to the Patriots training camp, or the Red Sox, wherever else it is, Western Maryland College, out in the middle of nowhere. Alan Ameche, no air conditioning, 10 to 15,000 people show up for practice every day. Alan Ameche's room, blaring there, is opera. Drop out of all of this stuff. I'm saying, are you in training camp for like the Philadelphia Orchestra, the BSO? Big Daddy Lipscomb marching these players up and down like a drill team. Walk into the locker room. I see Raymond Berry, it is a true story. He was one leg shorter than the other, and he washed his own pants. There he is in the sink. I'm saying, what the hell is this? Is this a football camp? Well, what's going on here? And so you saw all of these characters, these individuals. Unitas, who was Mount Olympus, but didn't act like Brady. And you had a lot of other people. Gino Marchetti and Art Donovan, whose father, by the way, refereed more championship bouts than anybody in history. Donovan walks over, you ain't gonna get that day. "Hi kid, welcome to the Colts. Anything we can do for you?" Same way with Gino. I mean, it was a totally different atmosphere.